This is Duke University.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you so much for coming and joining us on this festive evening. My name is Deborah Jensen, and I, as director of the John Hope Franklin Humanities Institute, I couldn't be more proud to moderate this faculty book watch event on the latest publication of one of our most humble and yet titled faculty members, Richard H. Brodhead, William Preston Few Professor of English and ninth president of Duke University. The FHI and Duke Libraries first inaugurated our co-sponsored Bookwatch series in 2004 with the expanded edition of Kathy Davidson's Revolution and the Word. It so happens that President Brodhead was a respondent for that inaugural Bookwatch event. And to our knowledge, to date, Dick is the only member of our community to serve at different times as both a panelist and a featured author. I'm sure I'll hear afterwards that there's another exception, but we're not aware of it.
Rarely true.
And indeed, it feels to me as though the Franklin Humanities Institute has been waiting since its inception to celebrate the humanities literary acumen of a scholar president like Dick Brodhead. And it is only fitting that President Brodhead is heading into his literary retirement, publishing with an eloquence that many young scholars might envy. As a scholar of 19th century American literature, Dick has authored or edited at least a dozen books on the richly diverse literary culture of the United States. The imaginative landscapes of Nathaniel Hawthorne, Herman Melville, Charles W. Chestnut, William Faulkner, Harriet Beecher Stowe, Louisa May Alcott, Richard Wright, and Eudora Welty, among others. He is a proponent, as you will note from his address to the American Academy of Arts and Sciences, of which he is a member, of literature as life. He can probe the marvels of mimesis, the representation of reality, from every angle, while also working on fundraising to increase financial aid to make an education at Duke fully accessible to anyone admitted. Education is Empowerment is another title of a chapter in his book, and he has been determined to make education work harder, take its power to more people and places in Duke Engage and in the globalization of Duke research and pedagogy. Yet he is no bureaucrat. It would be an error, he notes, quote, to think that anyone's formal education could possess lasting adequacy for the life of their times. And indeed, we must embark on education at our core, an education that we can renew every day of our lives in any circumstance. One of a shrinking cohort of humanities faculty in the presidencies of Research One universities, Dick Brodhead has made his Duke presidency an invaluable pulpit for the role of the humanities in a resilient, dialogic, changing, healthy society. He served as co-chair of the Commission on the Humanities and Social Sciences, created by the American Academy of Arts and Sciences at the request of a bipartisan group of congressmen and senators to bolster teaching and research in the humanities and social sciences. The commission issued its report, The Heart of the Matter, The Humanities and Social Sciences for a Vibrant, Competitive, and Secure Nation in June 2013. Many of you will remember satisfying great belly laughs while watching his discussion of The Heart of the Matter on the Colbert Report, which is really one of the most witty and surprising guest features of a university president in any forum. He delivered the keynote address at the Democracy and the Humanities Symposium commemorating the 50th anniversary of the founding of the National Endowment for the Humanities. And he has also served in crucial roles in philanthropic support of education and the humanities. He was a trustee of the Carnegie Corporation of New York from 2004 to 2012 and held a presidential appointment to the Fulbright Foreign Scholarship Board. In 2013, he was named a trustee of the Andrew W. Mellon Foundation. He received the Academic Leadership Award from the Carnegie Corporation in 2013. Prior to coming to Duke, Dick Brodhead had a 32-year career at Yale University. Born in Dayton, Ohio, he graduated from Yale as an undergrad in 1968 and received his PhD there in 1972. He joined the Yale faculty, where he served as the A. Bartlett Giamatti Professor of English and American Studies. A devoted teacher, he won the Devane Medal for Outstanding Teaching at Yale and spent 8 summers teaching high school teachers at the Breadloaf School of English at Middlebury College. After serving as chair of Yale's Department of English for 6 years, he was named Dean of Yale College in 1993 and served in the post for 11 years until he assumed Duke's presidency. His Yale writings are collected in The Good of This Place, Values and Challenges in College Education. So this is really a continuous rhetorical legacy of his administrative work. When I've listened to President Brodhead's speeches at Duke, I've been delighted by the conspiratorial tone of his humor. Education is a game, and our minds react with the alacrity of children for whom play is work. The voice is spellbinding, and the most erudite references of history and literature come alive on the field on which we are all players. Before moving on to our panel of dreams for Dick's Bookwatch, I'd like to thank Nasher Museum Director Sarah Schroth for her generous offer of the use of this remarkable space. And I would be remiss not to thank FHI Program Coordinator Sarah Rogers for the uniform excellence of her work, and Carolyn Gerber from President Brodhead's office for her generous and gentle insights. Now to my illustrious predecessor at FHI, Ian Baucom, the Buckner W. Clay Dean of Arts and Sciences at the University of Virginia. He moved to UVA in 2014 after working for 17 years at Duke, where he served as professor of English and director of FHI. Since arriving at UVA, he has worked with faculty on a series of initiatives, including an extraordinarily ambitious and successful hiring campaign, the first comprehensive revision of the undergraduate curriculum in several decades, programs to strengthen the graduate school, and advance a pan-university research program in global studies, neuroscience, and the environment. He earned his undergraduate degree in political science. In political science from Wake Forest University, and holds a master's degree in African studies and a doctorate in English, both from Yale. Ian is the author of Out of Place, Englishness, Empire, and the Locations of Identity, also of Specters of the Atlantic, Finance Capital, Slavery, and the Philosophy of History, and he is co-editor of Shades of Black, Assembling Black Arts in 1980s Britain. He's currently working on a book on the humanities and climate change. I had the honor of hearing a preview of that book in a talk he gave in Buenos Aires in February, and I and the rest of the audience are actively waiting to put that book to use in our classrooms and quotations. Ian first got to know President Brodhead while pursuing his PhD in English at Yale in the early 1990s, and then in his work as an assistant professor while Dick was Dean of Yale College. And during those years, he came to know President Brodhead as a leading scholar of American literature, one of the nation's most extraordinary advocates for the place of the humanities, and a lifelong mentor. He counts the subsequent years at Duke when the wheels of academic fortune spun luckily, and he was able again to work for President Brodhead as one of the defining gifts of his life. William C. Kirby is Spangler Family Professor of Business Administration at Harvard Business School and T.M. Chang Professor of China Studies at Harvard University. He is a University Distinguished Service Professor. He serves as chairman of the Harvard China Fund, the university's academic venture fund for China, and faculty chair of the Harvard Center Shanghai, Harvard's first university-wide center located outside the United States. a historian by training, Bill Kirby examines contemporary China's business, economic, and political development in an international context. He writes and teaches on the growth of modern companies in China, Chinese corporate law and company structures, business relations across Greater China, and China's relations with the United States and Europe. He has authored or co-authored more than 50 Harvard Business School cases on business in China. His current projects include a comparative study of higher education in China, Europe, and the United States. His most recent book is Can China Lead? At Harvard, Bill has served as chair of the History Department, director of the Harvard University Asia Center, director of the Fairbanks Center for Chinese Studies, and dean of the Faculty of Arts and Sciences. He is also a fellow of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences. Bill first came to know President Brodhead when Dick was dean of Yale College and Kirby was dean of the Faculty of Arts and Sciences at Harvard, and when both were pursuing the exciting, if unenviable, task of rethinking undergraduate education at their respective institutions. More recently, he has served as President Brodhead's senior advisor on China as Duke began the planning, building, staffing, and opening of an altogether new enterprise, Duke Kunshan University. Bill strongly recommends that a generous donor be found to name DKU's undergraduate college as Brodhead College in honor of a man who is second to none in his devotion to the liberal arts and sciences at home and abroad. Richard J. Powell is the John Spencer Bassett Professor of Art and Art History at Duke University, where he has taught since 1989. He studied at Morehouse College and Howard University before earning his doctorate in art history at Yale University. Along with teaching courses in American art, the arts of the African diaspora, and contemporary visual studies, he has written extensively on topics ranging from primitivism to postmodernism and pop art in the Haitian diaspora in France, including such titles as Homecoming, The Art and Life of William H. Johnson, Black Art, A Cultural History, and Cutting a Figure, Fashioning Black Portraiture. Rick is a recognized authority on African-American art and culture and has helped organize numerous art exhibits, including the Black Aesthetic, the Blues Aesthetic, Black Culture and Modernism, and Archibald Motley, Jazz Age Modernist. His current book project is on Black visual satire, which will examine satirical cartoons, paintings, and films and videos by African-American artists from the Harlem Renaissance to the present. And last, but definitely not least, Sarah Beckwith is the author of Christ's Body, Identity, Culture, and Society in Late Medieval England, also Signifying God, Social Relation and Symbolic Act in the York Corpus Christi plays, and Shakespeare and the Grammar of Forgiveness. She is currently working on a book on Shakespeare's late tragedies called Late Have I Loved You, and a further book on Shakespeare's The Winter's Tale called The Book of Second Chances. This book derives from her long fascination with the play and her experience in the classroom with it. And I have to say, I've heard several undergrads speak up about their experiences in your class and coming to the humanities because of it. She is one of the founding editors of Reformations, a book series with the University of Notre Dame Press, and a co-editor of the Journal of Medieval and Early Modern Studies. She is the sometime director of Duke in London and one-time chair of theater studies and the current undoubtedly one-time chair of English studies. So she says, but she's... she wrote, all my Yale-y friends spoke very well about President Brodhead, so I was on the lookout before he set foot on campus. In my capacity as chair of both theater and English, I kept asking Dick to do things, and he kept saying yes. What a wonderful colleague that makes. In this happy state, I have grown to appreciate him more and more in this and many other ways. So now we will begin with Ian.
Thank you, Deborah. It is good to be here. At some point this past Sunday afternoon, with the Easter meal cooked and consumed, but the dishes not completely washed, and the colored eggs I was supposed to be hiding in our back garden still languishing in plain view of our puzzled children, my beloved wife, Wendy, found me in our living room, heels kicked back, reading a book. "How's it going?" she asked, which, after almost 30 years of marriage and a long acquaintance with that particular lift of her eyebrows, I have come to know means many things, except, "How's it going?" But I was in a blissful mood. "Amazing," I answered, and I showed her the cover of the book. "I can't tell you how good it is to be back in Dick's company." And magically, because we all know there's something just a little bit magical about invoking Dick's name, like a swish of the magician's cloak, that's all it took. "Keep reading," she said. "You need his company." Who doesn't? If there's anything else this book reminds you of, it's who doesn't want to be in the company of Dick Brodhead? Who doesn't want to be in the company of a president who, with such joyful delight, can stand with teasing splendor before an assembled class of arriving freshmen in Duke Chapel, ironically calling attention to his formal splendor? Do you see your president, regally dressed and obviously equipped with supernatural powers, before, scant minutes later, turning that quip into a challenging account of Aristotle's explanation of the best use of power? Happiness, he urged them to consider as they began their time at Duke, is the best use of your powers along lines of excellence. Who wouldn't want to be in the company of a president who greeted his first class of Duke PhD students by wryly accusing them of a troubling recidivism? "After 4 years of college, here you are, back again. What's the matter? Couldn't you take life on the outside?" And then who walked them through as compactly insightful an account of how their choice of an academic career could simultaneously advance the frontiers of knowledge and the public good, as I have read. Who wouldn't want to be in the company of a president who, forsaking all pieties, pledged in his inaugural address to forsake all other academic loyalties and, quote, "take you, Duke, to be my chosen life"? Accused as he was by his legions of devotees in New Haven when they heard of his move south, of leaving Yale for someone younger and more athletic. And then spun that witticism into a stirringly serious reflection on the meaning of choosing, of being and joining, of the task of a president, quoting as he did a line by Rabbi Tarfon from the Pirkei Avot: "You are not required to complete the work, but neither are you free to desist from it." Listen to those words again. They are in Dick's first major speech to the university, in his inaugural address. "You are not required to complete the work, but neither are you free to desist from it." Who do you think those words address? All of us, of course, as his gloss of the rabbi's line makes clear, in one of those many, many moments in which the book reveals the coming together of the president and the English professor, or more precisely, reveals a president who not only spoke of and for the humanities, but who has stewarded the university through a living engagement with the humanities, through a finely ingrained and never abandoned habit of close reading, reading Virgil, Wordsworth, Whitman, Blake, Chestnut, Stevens, and hear the words of Rabbi Tarfon: "You are not required to complete the work, but neither are you free to desist from it." Who is that you? Who neither completes the work nor desists from it? All of us, as Dick's inaugural discursus makes clear, all of us, quote, as humans, making a better world wherever we happen to find ourselves, with whatever tools we have in hand. He is right. And it is one of the deep legacies of his presidency and one of the constant imperatives of the book, echoed in speech after speech, that that is a core expectation he has put before everyone who is part of Duke, to continue in the unfinished making of Duke, and in making Duke to make a better world. But more than a decade after he gave that inaugural speech in the ringing vault of Duke Chapel, we can certainly recognize that there was one particular audience member Dick had in mind. The man speaking those words and giving himself that charge. You are not required to complete the work, but neither are you free to desist from it. Nor has he. Over 13 years, remarkably chronicled by this book, which reads not so much like a compilation of addresses than as a memoir of a life lived in public with Cindy, never desisting from the work of Duke. Again and again as you read the book, and you need to read it from beginning to end, two guiding poles for his approach to that work come brightly through. The first is joy, delight, exuberance, play. Lovingly telling his first class of graduating seniors, quote, if this were a basketball game and you were the opposition, we would have reached the point when rude Duke fans would chant, start the bus. If I were not your best friend and well-wisher, I might even stretch forth my hand, waggle my fingers, and launch a cry of, see ya. And then linked to this evident delight he has in his beloved Dukies, there is a clear and constant teacherly insistence that he demands something more of them. Take a look again at his very first convocation speech to a class of incoming freshmen. He encourages them to read Hobbes and Winthrop, to reflect on what it means not merely to join, but to collectively author a community, to enjoy both its privileges and to affirm a reciprocal set of obligations to one another. And then he asks them a more difficult thing, to refuse to translate those obligations into a hollowed out determination to be pleasant to one another, but instead to resolve to be obliged to one another by arguing the passion of their convictions, different as those may be, in the conviction, quote, that since powerful differences shape the force field of our lives, the sides had better learn something about each other, and dare one hope it, learn something from each other, unquote. That, as he notes, is what the poet Blake called mental strife. And mental strife is the foundation of an academic community. That on day one, with his first class of Dukies, who he is so delighted to welcome and so eager to teach. And then beyond those features, the joyful and the teacherly, there are two other signature aspects of Dick's presidency that the book so strikingly reveals: the ethical and the you. To read this book is to be struck by the constant ethical seriousness with which Dick has pursued his life. And it is to be struck that the obligations of his position have required him to make so many ethical decisions in public, something most of us are never asked to do in quite the same way, with so many watching. On that front, the book also reveals one other thing. While the time for making an ethical decision sometimes comes slowly, with time to pause and deliberate and think, sometimes it comes fast. In the life of a university president, it almost always comes fast. This is nowhere more evident than in remarks at a community forum on a racial incident, given on the steps of Duke Chapel on April 1st, 2015, before an audience of 1,000 students, faculty, and others. Take the time to read those remarks. They are powerful. They are clear. Their ethical compass is unwavering. But part of what is so remarkable is that they are there, fully formed, ready to be spoken in public on mere hours' notice. The words are right, but the fact that the words are ready so rightly on such short notice is the sign of a life long well considered and long well lived. Read those comments alongside almost any other speech in this book, and you will find the principles and convictions they express re-articulated, reaffirmed, not readied for the moment, but ready in the moment, because they were always already there. And then, to conclude, there is the you. You know what I mean. Dick is the most eloquent person most of us have met. Part of the secret of that eloquence is an idiosyncrasy. There are times when he seems to have forgotten that the third person exists. When he introduces someone, he doesn't say, "She did this remarkable thing. Then she went on to that extraordinary feat." He says, "You did this remarkable thing. Then you went on to that extraordinary feat." And the person being introduced doesn't feel as if they are being introduced. They feel befriended. They feel as if they have been drawn into the best of all possible company. Reading this book is like that. That's how I felt on Sunday, and what Wendy knew I was feeling, and what you will feel. 1 year after coming to Durham, in his annual address to the faculty, Dick told his audience, "Since arriving here, I've needed both to learn Duke and to learn how to describe or project the idea of Duke. If you've heard me speak, you have listened to me struggling to articulate my emerging understanding of the strengths and aspirations of this place." To read this book is to listen to the record of that voice, speaking over the course of a decade, exploring, discovering, and performing the strengths and aspirations of this place, describing Duke, projecting the idea of Duke, but never speaking beyond you, never solitary and uninterested in you, always directly addressing you, wryly teasing you, seriously inviting you to come along and do your part, to participate in the unfinished co-authoring of this community. And for that, Mr. President, we thank you.
It is for me, I know as for all of us, a real honor to be asked to come to honor Dick Brodhead and the publication of Speaking of Duke. I especially like the subtitle, Leading the 21st Century University. For Dick and Duke have defined what a great university can be in the 21st century. As Deborah noted, I'm currently writing a comparative study of universities, series of 8 different case studies over 3 continents, of which Duke under Dick is in many ways the most extraordinary. I've read in Duke's archives of earlier generations who sought to have, and I quote here from an early report, "a university as fine as its architecture," end quote. But as Dick leaves this office, Duke's accomplishments and aspirations have soared higher than Duke Chapel, and indeed all the way to China. On China, I had the great pleasure of working with and for Dick in the creation of Duke Kunshan University. Kunshan Duke Dashui, just in case you needed the Chinese. My guess is that 10 years ago, very few of the Duke faculty had heard of Kunshan, which, after all, was last famous in the world of education somewhere around the late Ming Dynasty. But they've heard of it now, and not only in many of Dick's speeches in this book, but in their own engagement in doing something that comes along very seldom, if ever, in life, but has come to Duke and to Dick in this time, the opportunity to imagine and to create an altogether new university in the world's oldest and newest system of higher education. It was, as Dick told the Duke faculty in his speech of February 2011, an opportunity to do in China what Duke does so well here in Durham, to educate students to solve complex problems for the larger human good. And in this enterprise for Duke in China, he noted that, quote, "if our Chinese partners want to recreate a world-class form of education, they need to grapple with the spirit as well as the letter of our ways." Well, the spirit of our ways, as any reader of Dick's speeches, and I do want to emphasize, you know, I can't think how many other speeches are worth reading. of university presidents. This is really a fantastic book, as a book. The Spirit of Our Ways, if you know this book, but or if you've read Dick's study for the American Academy of Arts and Sciences, this refers above all to the liberal arts, to the arts and sciences that liberate us to be skeptical, independent learners who have the skill to learn what we don't know, not just in college, but over the course of a lifetime. And it's very fitting, it seems to me, that the distinguishing trait of Duke Kunshan University will be less its origins out of the aspirations of the Fuqua School, though it was really a damn good idea, nor its record in small-scale graduate education, which it is doing very well right now. This will instead be known and remembered as a liberal arts college, very possibly the liberal arts college, in China at a time of relentless expansion, experimentation, and constant contestation about what it means to be educated in that country. It's very easy to question this mission. After all, isn't China a place that graduates engineers and imprisons poets? Not all of them, I promise you. But it is a vision that Dick shared with one of China's preeminent universities, Tsinghua, in his speech of January 2014 on that campus, quoting, among others, Wilhelm von Humboldt, the father of all modern universities, and of concepts of Lehrfreiheit and Lernfreiheit, of the freedom to teach and the freedom to learn. And he gave a message that should be well received by that university, once known as China's MIT, but now at the forefront of internationalization and experimentation also in the liberal arts. If Dick's vision for DKU as a place where the humanities can flourish, reimagined and unencumbered, side by side with the sciences, this will be a special gift to Duke and an extraordinary gift to China. After all, China is home to the world's largest continuous civilization with the longest continuing sets of humanistic traditions. These are traditions that are being rediscovered every day. As some of you who know your history will know, that the old Chinese examination system, lasting for a millennium until about the year 1905, brought the most learned men into the realm of the service of the country, not because they'd been trained in any specialization, but because they had been educated, but because they had studied what we would today call the humanities. They had studied, they had memorized, they had chanted, and metaphorically consumed the classics so that they would, once in office, act according to the principles of human behavior that could be found in the Analects and the Mencius and other great works. Just think about it. There has seldom been a higher academic ideal, good people embarking on the living study of great books in order to do good work in society, what Dick calls education for the larger human good. Now, in this country, as you know, there's a lot of hand-wringing. We've heard it on the ACLS board as well, about the crisis of the humanities in the United States. And it's important to worry about the future of the humanities in the United States. I mean, a humanist, to paraphrase a Chinese phrase, a humanist should be the first to worry about the worries of the world and the last to take pleasure in its pleasures. But here at Duke, or at my university at Harvard, there is no crisis in the humanities at these two exceptional places. They thrive extraordinarily well, for example, at the Franklin Institute here at Duke. But China is a place where there has been and remains an enduring crisis of the humanities over the last century and more, a time in which, in lieu of the humanities and in lieu of the study of the classics, two dominant themes prevailed. One, a belief in science, that in an age of science, one could quite literally engineer a bright future and a new people. The dream of Chinese leaders from Sun Yat-sen right down to Xi Jinping of a government of technocratic expertise, of an engineering state unleashed and unchecked. A second, much more dangerous belief in the 20th century was that culture matters, but culture and the arts are to be subordinated to the purposes of the party and the state, Or as Mao Zedong put it in a famous, if complicated, phrase, literature and art should be, quote, the artistic crystallization of the political aspirations of the Communist Party. That's a nice use for literature and art. As Lu Xun, the great writer, once observed, all art may be propaganda, but not all propaganda is art. Well, modern Chinese history has lessons for us. It shows what dislocation can ensue when a civilization loses its cultural foundations, loses its moral compass on a relentless quest for wealth and power. In that quest, China over the last century imported all kinds of Western isms, scientism, militarism, Leninism, chief among them, and denigrated nearly every aspect of a civilization that had been the most sophisticated and accomplished on Earth just a century and a half before. Today, in Kunshan and across the land, a more self-confident China is beginning to explore its past, inviting others, such as Duke, in order to learn from others and to make both part of a modern education. Thanks to Dick's vision of the enduring and encompassing value of the humanities and the liberal arts more generally, the more important developments in Kunshan over the next several years will not be the iPhone 8 or iPhone 9, though they will be made in Kunshan, but instead a university founded in the belief that there is more to education than can be measured in iPhones, more in education than can be measured in dollars or renminbi. A university grounded in multiple civilizations and with a recognition that in an age perhaps still consumed with wealth and power, that as countries vie for power and individuals seek to accumulate wealth, an education that stresses the values that make for a strong and harmonious human community are more important than ever before. Only with such a foundation, as Dick has argued in speeches in China, can we possibly be prepared for a future of the unexpected and the unknown. And this is our collective human challenge on either side of the Pacific. The unexpected and the unknown will be with us soon enough. How very important it is then that in Durham, as in Kunshan, the Chinese phrase can remind us, Shu Tu Tong Gui, we have myriad paths, but our ends are one. So let us celebrate a real celebrator of the humanities, a humanist, a globalist, and always an optimist of the highest order, Dick Brodhead.
Thank you, Professor Jensen, for including me in this amazing event. And thank you, President Brodhead, for your remarkable book. On the face of it, the idea of compiling a collection of addresses, speeches, and comments by a college or university president isn't something that one would expect to generate great interest outside of college and university administrators and the academy in general. But President Richard H. Brodhead's speaking of Duke leading the 21st century university is different. Yes, the themes that one might count on from such a collection of scholarly speeches and talks, university convocations, big picture policy pieces, special events related remarks, etc., are certainly contained within these assorted addresses. But what distinguishes this thoroughly readable collectanea from your average anthology from the lofty echelons of higher education is a marked humility, an emphatic sense of purpose, and a refreshing erudition. Any good writer can certainly assume a socially empathetic perspective as they develop an argument or take a position. But it is very difficult, if not outright impossible, to simulate a connectedness with your audience and to convey sympathy across a readership's broad demographic if, indeed, there is no connection or genuine love. Reading Speaking of Duke, I was struck time and time again by those intermittent points when President Brodhead paused and made a personal aside that reminded the audience that rather than being lectured, they were colloquially being brought into a grand conversation of great consequences by someone who intuitively understood his role, not only as a designated leader and spokesperson, but as a feeling and thinking person amongst others. Again, this is not something you can affect. One has to respect one's audience and acknowledge one's humanity and imperfections in order to speak difficult truths and propose a way forward. The address in Speaking of Duke that perfectly illustrates this quality of terrestrial humility is President Brodhead's testimonial to Mary Duke Biddle Trent Siemens. When toward the end of this pithy memorial, President Brodhead deftly reminds us that Mary Siemens saw more good in others than any of us are used to seeing in ourselves, and she made you want to be the person she believed in. The psychological transference between a disinterested party and a beloved community only works because President Brodhead reminds us that he too is among those who was inspired to a higher calling by Mary Siemens. This oratorial act is less an artful strategy than it is an introspective and empathetic acknowledgement. My PhD advisor at Yale University, the eminent art historian Robert Ferris Thompson, used to say to me about public discourse that you have to be a believer, meaning you can't make an effective case for anything unless you really, really believe in and support the cause. This same sentiment might be extended to leadership in a college or university, that in order to be a successful leader, there needs to be a resounding, almost visceral intentionality to achieve an objective, from capturing people's divided attentions to marshaling wide support for various initiatives. President Brodhead's 2011 faculty address, Budgets, International Opportunities, and the Humanities, was precisely that kind of purposeful statement, a testimony to the economic realities that Duke faced in 2011, and a heartfelt articulation of the value and worth in international scholarly exchanges and humanistic research that only a believer could voice and reason to the university's multitudes. When the budget is flush and bears potential risk, it is easy to call for programmatic exuberance. But when the budget is compromised, it takes both courage and resolve to face one's constituents and promote self-discipline and a willingness to set priorities. Reading President Brodhead's call to exercise virtues you may have grown tired of is a fascinating case study in purposeful rhetoric, made even more decisive and resolute through his clarity of vision and guarded optimism for the future. The section of the same faculty address that calls for Duke to wholly embrace an outward-looking international view is similarly firm in the conviction that this global shift is the inevitable future trajectory for major institutions of higher learning in the United States. Although the Duke University Kunshan China collaboration is President Brodhead's primary example here, he prefaces it with a more philosophical but nonetheless powerful argument for the university's increasingly undertaking more international projects. As places devoted to understanding the world and transmitting that understanding to the rising talent of the future, President Brodhead writes, universities have a fundamental stake in deepening their grasp of the globalizing world. The four reasons he enumerates for this cosmopolitanization of Duke: one, tapping a transnational talent pool; two, facilitating intellectual partnerships unconstrained by long distances; 3, the democratization and dispersal of knowledge beyond the expected players. And 4, deprovincializing us here at home. Speak to the various counterarguments that would have us turn our backs to the wider world and temper any desires for deeper and more complex perspectives. Neither blind to the potential pitfalls in international partnering, nor Pollyanna-ish about the inevitable conflicts that arise from experiencing a clash of cultures, President Brodhead's case for international opportunities reverberates with an abiding faith and vision in this transnational course that remarkably is simultaneously clear-eyed and inspiring. President Brodhead ends this faculty address with a praise song to humanistic inquiry at Duke, detailing a few of the cutting-edge humanities activities here, from the Visual Studies Initiative and Global Health Institute to the Winter Forum and the Haiti Lab that enrich a liberal arts education. Briefly returning to the theme of Duke in China, President Brodhead reminds us that understanding China requires that we not only expand our spoken and written language skills and immerse ourselves in that country's history, society, and culture, but that we have a responsibility to frame our investigation within a larger humanistic study, and that we'll be at an utter loss if, additionally, we do not have recourse to ethics, the history of religion, political philosophy, cultural anthropology, international relations, and international law. Calling out the at times marginalization of the humanities by institutional skeptics, as well as the at times too introspective or muddled voices of humanists within the modern university, President Brodhead admonishes us with love, reminding his audience that Duke can't be great without a curriculum built on the broad-based combinatory learning we call the liberal arts. And let's face it, President Brodhead has the credentials as a renowned literary critic in his own right and learned humanist to level these tough but circumspect critiques. Indeed, the recurring element throughout speaking of Duke leading the 21st century university is President Brodhead's professorial poise, his unapologetic love of literature, and their shared utility in helping to address the educational and administrative challenges that Duke has faced. Inserting a Wallace Stevens poem in a faculty address, or quoting John Hope Franklin in a freshman convocation speech, President Brodhead inveigles us to not only become more literate, culturally conversant, and humanistic in our purviews, but he employs poetry and social history as voices of reason, reservation, and righteousness in his goal of articulating Duke's educational mission, errands, and promise. I love it that Duke's president is as likely to quote Coleridge, Chestnut, Emerson, and Thoreau as referencing stock market indices and financial forecasts. Again, speaking of Duke, leading the 21st century university is not your typical assembly of official speeches and ceremonial addresses. What it is a chronicling of the highlights and challenges of a major research university through the all-observant eyes and deep cerebrations of a scholar leader whose intellectual gifts and affinity for humanity set an inspiring, even visionary, tone through that institution's first 2 decades in a new millennium. Thank you.
Thank you, Deborah, and thank you, Dick, very much for asking me to do this. Jeanette Winterson's beautiful memoir, Why Be Happy When You Could Be Normal, is a biography of a reader, a book about reading, reading for your life. Apart from the Bible, there are 6 other books in the Plymouth Brethren Winterson household, and they are all nonfiction.
Mrs. Winterson bans the reading of fiction, so young Jeanette reads in secret in the outside lavatory or under covers at night, carefully depositing each read book under the mattress until the whole mattress floats so dangerously high it threatens to reveal the reading habits so vicious in her mother's eyes, but that are most literally sustaining and maintaining her. Mrs. Winterson reads the Bible. Young Jeanette has a memory of Jane Eyre read aloud in her mother's good reading voice, but it's been doctored with the skill of a clever reader and astute stylist so that Jane marries St. John Rivers and goes off to the missions with him. T.S. Eliot makes her cry in Accrington Public Library because his line, "This is one moment, but know that another shall pierce you with a sudden joy from murder in the cathedral," gives her hope to survive the moment she's in. And so does Gertrude Stein saying to Alice B. Toklas, "Right or wrong, this is the road and we are on it." Jeanette Winterson says that she puts herself inside books for safekeeping. She says a tough life needs a tough language. The people around her have that tough language. She hears lines she later locates in Shakespeare, a writer she regards as not part of the alphabet any more than black is a color. When she's homeless and living in her mini, supporting herself at the local sixth form college by working in the weekend markets and organizing books at the local library, she reads English literature A to Z at the Accrington Public Library, which is the title of one of her best chapters in the memoir. Books are home when she's homeless. They are medicines, doses, saving lives from isolation and the suffering that comes from not feeling that anything about your life is recognizable to others or intelligible to yourself, and thus a cast away from the tribe of human. Readers need books, and they need teachers and good critics. They need fine universities too, led by people who understand that these are founding necessities and not luxuries. They need libraries. The Accrington Public Library, endowed by the Carnegie Foundation in 1906, sporting on its facade the heads of Shakespeare, Milton, Chaucer, and Dante, supplied the fragile public space to make available English literature A to Z. The young Jeanette has reached M and is struggling with N because of Nabokov, who she finds disturbing and off-putting. At this point, Mrs. Ratlow, her sixth form college teacher, argues with her about Mrs. Oliphant, who should not be in English literature A to Z. Discovering her living conditions, you are living in a mini, and when you are not, in fact, in the mini, you are working on the market to earn money, or you are here at the college, and otherwise you are in the Accrington Public Library reading English literature in prose A to Z, she gives her a room in her house. Why be happy when you could be normal? Which is what Mrs. Winterson tells her on the declaration that the young Jeanette loves girls and not boys, reminds us of the uses of literature, one of which is recognition. Perhaps some of us who have found our way into professing literature might once have read for our lives. Winterson's memoir reminds us of the complex social, cultural, utterly contingent, now precarious conditions that sustain such a reading life. Throughout the speeches in this marvelous connection, we meet Dick as a reader, a writer working out of his reading. We meet him as one who seems to want to prompt and inspire in us the memories, consciousness, indeed conscience of our own bibliomorphos or life with the arts. In his keynote address for the 50th anniversary of the founding of the National Endowment for the Humanities, Dick Brodhead rolls up his sleeves. With a steely, trained optimism and a certain restrained impatience, he says to the Jeremiahs, hand-wringers, whingers, Gradgrinds, professional pessimists, and pro- and anti-humanist hardheads that there is work to be done. And this comes with a graceful but sharp admonition. Don't be like the traveller who speaks the same phrase more slowly and loudly so that the poor idiot foreigner in her own country, one assumes, can understand. In the John Taylor Caldwell lecture on the humanities, he says what we need before we ask for other investments is to challenge ourselves to say what the humanities are good for. And as simply and as truly as we can manage with examples that prove the point. Many of the addresses in Speaking of Duke give examples of Dick reading and experiencing those life-enhancing, life-defining shocks of recognition that literature may afford. When at the age of 14 he reads Shakespeare's sonnet 29, when in disgrace with fortune and men's eyes, I all alone beweep my outcast state, he wonders how Shakespeare could have possibly handed him back to himself, how he could have voiced a self-knowledge unavailable but through that voicing. Later, standing over the body of someone he loves, he understood, as he inhabited, words he thought he knew from King Lear. Why should a dog, a horse, a rat have life, and thou no life at all? Later still, we can read about Dick going to the special collection at the Fisk University Library, where he reads Charles Chestnut's journals of 1874 to 1882. He shares his reading with us, and it's both a drama and a narrative, so that through the young writings of this great African-American writer and social reformer, he and we participate in a vital conversation about education in rural North Carolina. In such experiences, we come to ourselves and see how the lines of a culture meet in us. When Dick says that we need to say what the humanities are good for, as simply and as truly as we can manage, I have in mind then his own readings. He wants to connect us to things we know but might have forgotten. He is convinced that that experience, that memory, will assuage the current panic and anxiety about the humanities that causes us to forget that we are quite inescapably expressive creatures, that all reference passes through expression, our expression. Any defense of the humanities based on an impoverished account of our need for self-understanding is doomed to failure. Here's the thing. Such an account of the arts and humanities is itself aesthetic. We have to move example by example. I see this. Do you see it too? I'm not content to let you rest in your taste, but demand that you see this too. The claim of aesthetic judgment, as Kant taught us, is both subjective and universal. I can't encounter works of art without asking what counts for me and struggling to give voice to why it matters and how, so that you might be able to see it too. We are so lucky that Dick has been prepared to say what counts for him, and that he's done so with the honesty and integrity he both demands of others and inspires in them. I'm not all that fond of the word leadership, and I doubt that any of the 12-year-olds obliged to exhibit it are either. Where are all the followers going to be is not the first time that joke's been made. Before these 12-year-olds have to exhibit leadership before they even enter into the universities who want to train them in it. But staking yourself, exhibiting the honesty and integrity of exemplary judgment, especially when that involves an honest self-accounting, isn't this what it looks like? In these senses, then, absent hyperbole, absent the potential ongoing corruption of the concept, Dick has indeed led a 21st century university. A few final words. I was surprised at the very existence of Speaking of Duke. Stupid me. I have heard Dick speak on many occasions. We all know he doesn't read from notes. Though his eloquence, wit, and powers of articulation are legendary, his words always seem extemporary, as if he's just now thought of them. No, but really, who speaks like that? He can't simply just have thought about them. This is the Brodhead phenomenon. In this collection, I think we see the deep care behind all those addresses of academic life, a life full of ceremonies of initiation, qualification, valediction, full of rhythms of beginning, ending, and passing. Of course, there are no doubt many equally thoughtful speeches that do not make it into this book. Dick speaks with the same care and thought to the middle school spelling bees, as to the assembled ranks of the great and the good in other locales and on other occasions. He speaks of Duke, he speaks with it, and he speaks to it. He speaks to us for, and I did not confer with my former colleague, Ian. This book is about you. Dick's favorite locution is indeed the second person. The point is we, whoever we are on any particular occasion, are in the picture. There's this. Class of 2008, I have loved your company and it grieves me to see you go. And this, friends, are you sure you want to go through with this graduation? Also this, men and women of Duke, we have a great hope for you that in whatever career or sequence of careers awaits you, you will be repairers of a broken world. Did you know that Dick serves as an academic pre-major advisor? He has open office hours for students. He guest lectures on American literature in courses, has students over to Hart House for dinner. Did you know he came over to meet the theater studies students when they were in rehearsal for the Laramie Project? And it was hard to say who was more thrilled, they by his presence or he by entering into their lives at the level of spit and sawdust. He's come to every reading I've asked him to do, even in the most dispiriting weather. He's read in our marathon reading of Paradise Lost, Shakespeare's Sonnets in the Garden, and The Great Gatsby, where hundreds of people could see him on Facebook during the day's event. This is a faculty book watch. It's not a valediction or a vote of thanks, but please forgive me for saying, Dick, I will miss you as my president. Dick and Cindy, I look forward to being friends, neighbors, colleagues, fellow professors in the time to come, as you both continue to walk 10,000 miles, read 10,000 books.
Now comes the only moment in this event that will be hard to foresee in advance, which is I've known Deborah kindly thought of having a book watch about my book when she heard it was going to come out. I thought that was exceptionally thoughtful of you. I'm very appreciative. But as the time grew nearer, one wondered, what would it be like to endure this event? And I will say, I at first thought of it, you know the famous scene in Tom Sawyer where he comes into the church in which the funeral for him is being given. And it is a little like going to one's memorial service. But I discovered as it went on that that's not the analogy that really occurs to me. It's like waterboarding. I'm sitting here immobilized while being subjected to an endless inundation of this generous intelligence, with everybody only wondering one thing, which is whether I will be able to endure it. And I have wondered myself whether I would be able to endure it, and here I am apparently having endured it, and even enjoyed it, though I think I'll have to think about it in afterthought to be able to enjoy it in the pure sense. What did you say? We should be the first to worry about the worries of the world and the last to enjoy its pleasures. I may be the last to enjoy the pleasures of this thing. So let me just say, you can imagine, or maybe you can't imagine, because I couldn't have before this event, what it's like to take four of the people one has had the extraordinary good fortune to be colleagues with, people I know because we've worked on things together, we've discovered the values we share together, we've learned and taught each other, and then through that become the kind of friendship that's possible in the academic world, a friendship that's not separate from intellectual life but not reducible to it either. And I'd have to say, for me to come and hear me, Richard Brodhead, talked about in this way, let me step from behind the mask one moment. You know, we all hope that we're understood the way we wish we could be understood. And at least for one fleeting hour, it seems to me that this has been my privilege. I'm just going to say, I don't love to talk about me, but I'll say something about it, which is I did not begin my academic career as the kind of person who could have written a single item that appears in this book. When I became an academic, like everyone who became an academic, I learned how to write the kind of professional work I don't mean that satirically or reductively, but that's what one learned, is how to write the thoughts that only you had had to share with the small number of people who only cared about those kinds of thoughts. I've loved my scholarly work. I'm even proud of pieces of it. But I would say, from the beginning of my career, it was always true that that did not satisfy my wish for communication. One of the reasons why teaching was always so important to me is I didn't only want to teach things that only I knew a lot about. I wanted to teach. I wanted to open books up to myself and others, and open up domains of reflection that literature can open, whether you had anything special to say about them or not. And so then the funny thing about the arc of my career is, you know, when you're a faculty member or a student, you really have no idea how little you understand about universities. And I have come to appreciate the fact universities exist so that most people don't have to think about how universities work. That's the purpose of universities, is not to reflect on how they work. The purpose is to sustain an activity of reflection and exchange and transmission that takes place. It has an enabling context, but then you can forget about the context. Nevertheless, my career led me into a succession of jobs. I never regarded myself as having given up my first job, but I regarded it as a growth. And Bill, you had the same kind of growth and position. A series of jobs in which you actually got to learn how universities work. And not only that, but where then actually a funny thing started to happen to me, where you were asked to speak about universities in a way that factual accounts of them gave you almost no help with. So if you're speaking to a group of people arriving in college, either you are or you aren't going to take seriously the fact you have to try to reflect, what does it mean to start college? What might be accomplished here? What might be missed if you fail to think about that? Actually, I never had to think about that in the days when I was just teaching. But in the days when you're an administrator, you have to you're called to a certain profundity of reflection, and you do your best to articulate it. It has been a funny thing for me. You think that I actually write all my speeches and then later learn to deliver them in an impressionistic fashion. This is actually not true. I actually far prefer to speak without a text. And this book, some of the speeches in this book began as speeches. The one you mentioned, the day of the news, that was spoken and later transcribed. That's the way I far prefer to do it, because then you're in the presence of thinking, in the presence of the present moment of communication. But it has been for me a curious, unforeseen career that you get to stand in public and try to explain to others things about the meaning of universities, the meaning of learning, the meaning of the humanities. But there's always one person you're trying to speak to besides that person. And I think Ian really caught this. When I read these things, these works, I always recognize the sense in which they're addressed to myself. In which there are attempts to answer a question, or to try to come out, how close can you get in words to saying what you currently understand? How does an education inform a life over the arc of a life? This is something you know, if you do graduations, you're going to have to talk about that. And just to try to come up with answers, and then the next time to try to come up with a better answer. It has, you know, now, so now I'm going on sabbatical, you know. It has been a great joy. I hope that anyone who has known me has known how full of joy this job has been. Joy in the pleasures and joy in the challenges. And I wish everyone in the world, certainly I do when I look at students from the pulpit of Duke Chapel, may you have a life that gives you an opportunity to discover your gifts, as I feel mine has had mine has given me the chance to discover gifts I never knew I had. You know, do you have any idea how I used to dread public speaking? The first time I gave a lecture class, like, I stayed awake every night before every day I gave a lecture. It was just so appalling to think you were going to have to stand on that stage. You know, it gets easier. But anyway, only to say, you understand that, lacking in self-awareness as I am, I never knew I referred to people as you. You have been the willing or unwilling participants in the many episodes of my tour of duty as president. It has been a communal labor, and it has been a communal pleasure. I look at faces in this room and think of the happiness and pride for me of having the acquaintance of so many separate people are here. So, you know, the book, well, there it is.
So for Q&A, this can go between President Brodhead and the panelists. It can be from the audience to Dick or the panelists.
Just remember to put your answer in the form of a question.
And we have people with mics so that we can all hear you.
Quickly, Dick, you've got the translation rights in Chinese all done?
I thought you were doing it. You do know the only word in Chinese I truly know is duke da shi. Whether such a thing, you know, it's a funny thing when you title this book to have the name of the university in it, because it really virtually says to anybody who doesn't have a Duke affiliation, this is not for you. And realistically, I mean, you know, like how many people at the University of Missouri or what shall I say, Stanford are going to pick up a book called Speaking of Duke? Nevertheless, there's a sense in which it is all very immediate to the people, the place that you're talking about, but there's another sense in which it isn't. And I think that there's another sense in which it is, as you said, a kind of a memoir. I mean, really a kind of, I mean, when I read these works, I find them actually very personal. Behind a veil, I get to wear a robe when I give these talks, which of course creates a massive sense of impersonality. So that helps. Here's one, David Stein.
Go for it. What was the selection process for choosing the speeches that went in the book? Because there were so many good ones that were left out, but there were so many good ones in there. So describe a little bit about that process.
You a little bit had to think, what would be the possibility of an infinite appetite on the in the life of the hypothetical reader? Carolyn Gerber helped me relocate all of these, and in some cases even transcribe ones for which there had not been a text. And then you could look them over. You know, and some, I think, by virtue of the kind of event they were, had to be in there. The inaugural address has to be in there. And then there's ones, you know, there's ones that seem to me to hold up better than others. And so I'm not saying that I don't wish you to believe that everything not in this book is low class stuff. I don't want somebody who graduated in a certain year to look through the book and say, oh my God, the baccalaureate I got wasn't even worth including in this book. But the thing is, you really can't read 13 baccalaureate addresses. I mean, it turns out it's possible to write 13, or at least I'm one short of having proved it, but, I don't know. And just to tell you the truth, there was a moment when you also thought, how frank do you want this book to be? And so at a certain point, I opened it to include things that were controversial that one might have left out. And I even opened it to include something comical that might have been left out. And I'd have to say, not every moment one has lived through is a source of equal pleasure. But I think the book is more truthful for being more inclusive.
I had an almost identical question, but
maybe I'll give you the identical answer.
Whoa, thank you. But what was the last speech that you added to the book, and why did you include that particular one?
God knows. I'll tell you one, because I think I even know the answer. Okay, I have been asked to give commencement addresses at other schools. And let me tell you, it is hard to come up with a fresh commencement address every year. And the notion that you have to come up with two in the same week. So I gave one at Fisk once upon a time. This was very moving to me. This is the university where John Hope Franklin discovered the intellectual life and thus went on the trajectory to do the historical work for Brown v. Board of Education. It was a very moving occasion for me. But then, you know, on the Humanities Commission, there was this remarkable person named Eduardo Padron, who is not only the head, but really the genius behind this institution in Miami called Miami-Dade College. Miami-Dade College is the largest college in America. It has 180,000 students, and I think something like 90% of them are first generation. A huge preponderance of them are immigrants or children of immigrants. I was asked to do this, and if you read it, you'll see. Every sitting president, I think, since Jimmy Carter, or after Jimmy Carter, has spoken at this graduation, and when you go, you understand why, which is, you know, Duke is a wonderful place, but Duke is a little, very selective, little thing. But when you go to this graduation, that's amazing. Just the thought of the effort, the sacrifice, the meaningfulness of education to people who have persisted while having to hold two jobs to get to this thing. And the funny thing is, it hadn't crossed my mind, and then at the end you thought of it, and you thought, oh, that's one I really want to have in there. Okay, this one, go home and read it. Everything, opportunity changes everything, is the motto of that school, and the title of the talk. Please.
Thank you, Dick, and thank you to the panel. So my question is very much a historical one about the university as an institution and as a form, right? It is one of perhaps the oldest institutions and forms that still persists. What do you think is the difference the difference of a 21st century president of a university, say even from the past century, and especially of the president of an American university, you think, especially since we're moving into Kunshan?
If you really want an answer to this question, you should call on Bill Kirby, because his field is the comparative history of education from the von Humboldt experiment in from 1810 until DKU, next week, right? That's the span you're working across. I mean, the interesting thing about it is, I think, you know, there have been periods in history, there have been remarkable university presidents. The president of the University of Chicago, who devised basically the scheme of great books, had an incredible impact. When Conant was president of Harvard and came up with the theory of why the federal government should fund scientific research and why humanities should be taught at universities that had funded scientific research. This is the document that governed American university life in research universities for at least 40 years. And when it ceased to, that was not altogether a good thing. So there have been influential ones, but I also think that there have been times when I think there was a little of a period, you know, of course, my wife and I went to college in the middle of the student revolution, when the lives of presidents became a little less of a picnic in certain ways, though probably the early Cold War wasn't too much of a picnic either, if the truth were told. I don't know, it seems to me, I go to meetings of university presidents, it's a funny thing, you know, I've got my own little, shop I go to, where everybody has the same job you do. But the funny thing is, people do the job so differently from one another, I think. And maybe universities sustain different kinds of leadership too. I personally think that I have felt that we have been in a period when lucky, well-educated people understand why education is valuable. But we live in a country where education is more needed than ever, and the impoverishment of public understanding of why it's valuable has grown decade by decade by decade. That's where I sort of felt my calling in this work, to the extent that I've felt myself as a public speaker, is just to go out there and as many places as will invite you, just try to explain why is a short-term education less good for you than a long-term education? Why is something that develops the fullness of your powers better for you than something that develops the narrowness of your powers? And I still think, I'd have to say, I think that there is so much work to be done that if every president spent all day long doing this, you'd really never, you'd have to hope to begin to make a dent in it. I mean, for me, it's partly, people sometimes used to say, it was a question you often heard asked after the early 1970s, why don't presidents of universities speak out more on public issues? But the thing is, what business does the president have voicing his or her personal politics about things? I've thought that actually the president's obligation is to create the place where all kinds of views can be active, voiced, and interchanged. And so it's not the job of the president to say what views are officially valued here, but there are things that are universities' issues. We've all spoken out about the immigration issues recently and the immigration ban, not because it's a political issue, but because it's one that touches fundamentally on the enabling conditions of a university. Please.
Thank you, Dr. President Brodhead. Now, I think you have invested a lot for the DKU in the China, this university. So also you talk about a lot of humanities. You know the big difference of the cultures. So what is your ultimate goals or expectation for the DKU, and whether you think you will be able to achieve your expectation or goals, and are you happy with the progress?
Well, read the book and you can find out the multiple arguments why I would favor this, which I won't go into every one of them now. But I would say I a little bit differ. I don't think Bill and I really do differ, but you made it sound as if my concept of DKU was one where the humanities would be featured in a way. I don't disagree with that, but that's not my fundamental concept, and I think you actually did put it. The liberal arts for me isn't about having one half cup of humanities and one half cup of social sciences and one good cup of the sciences. It's about a spirit of inquiry. It's about the von Humboldt quote that I used at Tsinghua, trying to read the facial expressions on the people of the other side. Humboldt says, a modern university begins when teacher and student understand the idea of thinking of truth as an open question, that the questions that can be closed, the questions where the teacher can say the answer and the student can learn it, that's important, but that's not the stuff of a university. What we call research, that's inquiry. It's the shared progress of using as much communal intelligence as you can to go from what you currently understand to what you might eventually understand. We find Bill was very striking when we started our first programs at DKU. Bill went and was there very near the opening, and you called me and you said, what will be striking to you is not the formula of the liberal arts curriculum, but the culture of pedagogy that's present there. We had students from all the great Chinese universities came to spend terms there. These students were intoxicated by being in small classes where they were required, first with some awkwardness, since it was not a well-exercised skill, to enter into the project of being, you had a responsibility to participate in the work of inquiry with your alongside your professor rather than as the object of your professor's authority. I think that's an incredibly powerful thing. And what I find interesting is, it seems to me, the Chinese educators I know, they all get that, they all want that. We're not going to have a massive university there. But what we're doing there means to be something real in itself and paradigmatic beyond itself. And so that's why the fact that one of the hard jobs at DKU now is handling all the visitors from China who come who want to see how this thing works.
So, Dick, it's interesting. One thought, if I may, on this, at Chinese universities, historically, in the period of the People's Republic, they study the collected speeches of Chairman Mao.
Ah, oh, so there's hope
for
me.
Which I should tell you, he periodically edited out, people who had been purged or other things. And now they study the speeches, not in DKU, of Chairman Xi. So what plans do you have for your speeches to of a DKU curriculum?
Well, the trouble with this book, the book is beautifully produced, and my great gratitude to Duke University Press. I think they did a wonderful job. But you see that there should be a little pocket edition of it. That's more like, in my student days, the red book, it was pocket-sized, and it had some of the attributes of a Bible, right? It looked like a Bible, when somebody pulled it out. It wasn't like pulling out a paperback, right? Maybe in the second printing or the Chinese translation.
Do you know that on the little red book that Chairman Mao got royalties?
Oh, this was early capitalism. In the dark, all cats are gray, or whatever it was famously said. Bill, you said something that I found amusing, and I wonder if I'm the only one who did, which is you kept using the name Duke and the name Dick in very close proximity to each other. And actually, I find this a very funny thing. Surely no one had this in mind when I was hired here, but I mentioned to Sarah and I are trained in the history of the English language. There are these things periodically called vowel shifts, in which vowels, why is the word ham, the medieval word, so Tottenham, Twickenham, all of those, that's the same word as home, but the vowel has shifted. And so over some period of time, it's possible that I will be known as Duke Brodhead. Or, even more astonishingly, that this will be called Dick University. I think we better stop. Oh, okay, I can't deny Alex a question.
Yeah. One last question, but I will just mention that after Alex's question, if you're interested in buying a copy of said book, you can do so at the museum bookstore, and then there will be a table for book signings, and there will, of course, be a reception. So.
You've just given a wonderful example of the phenomena about which I want to ask you. The collected speeches are generally a very boring genre, and the convocation addresses, the other kinds of speeches that a president has to make are remarkably oratorical in their character, and yet your interventions are always so laced and laden with humor that more than once I've asked you in 13 years, who writes your material? And you always give me the same answer, but now I want to ask the question, can you reflect a little about the role of humor in your particular rhetorical style? Because it's extremely important. I have listened to you, for example, over 12 years wooing prospective AB Duke students, and every year it's an entirely different pattern, and every year you make professors and parents and students laugh. And it's an important, I think, a vehicle for the communication of what you want to say. And I would like to hear a little sort of scholarly and academic reflection.
I suppose you'd like me to try to answer truthfully.
Not required.
I'll try. I mean, how do I know the answer to this? This is the way I write. This is the way I speak. You know what? I actually don't like to go to boring speeches. This has been one of the guiding features of my work as a speaker. I don't like to go to speeches where the text is down, the person never looks up, you could have stayed home and read it online in a third the time, and done something else with the remainder of the time. This is why I like, you know, even when I'm speaking from a text, I actually typically know it well enough that I can speak right in your face to it, so that it's like a human communication. But the other thing is, when you're speaking, you know, often I don't intend to be funny, but you think of some way of putting something that's a little amusing. And I guess I'd say it's partly because I really do regard, if you can possibly avoid being boring, you owe it to people to avoid it. And you know, the one thing is, I hope, I actually think anybody who reads my writing will understand, my writing is painfully earnest. It is painfully earnest. And one of the reasons you need the humor in is to conceal the painfulness of the earnestness. But I mean, no, I don't think anybody would ever read anything by me and say, oh, that's just funny. My talks to the A.B. Duke, I've determined that every one of them, by Lord, is going to come to this university for the best of reasons. But you know, why can't it be some fun along the way? What was that line of yours? Why be normal when you could have fun?
Why be happy when you can be normal?
Why be happy when you can be normal? You know, okay. Maybe that's my motto as a speaker. Anyway, I don't know, whatever.
Produced by Duke University, online at duke.edu.